What I've done for the first class is just kind of give you a sense of what's going on, some of the elements of product design, some of my experiences in doing products for a long, long time. I started designing hardware in a long time ago, 40 years ago, and my first job was out of college was Polaroid, which was a really up-and-coming company and very, you know, sort of the Apple of the day, very liberal policies and just a very exciting place to work. And the but there's been a lot of changes over the years, but there's also a lot of similarities in terms of building products for wide acceptance, you know, the whole process you go through to make products manufacturable and ability to scale up. So, but then there's a lot of differences. And so what I'm going to do is kind of take you from a little bit in the early days to what's happening right now. And this, unfortunately, the screen doesn't give me a good view. Let's see. Okay, so a little bit of an introduction. I've developed products, you know, 800 products over the years, all mostly consumer-related, a lot of hardware, more recently hardware and software, and I've written a book which is called From Concept to Consumer, which basically, I wrote it because people that had ideas kept coming to me and asking questions and the same questions, and I thought, and I tried to find a book that I could refer them to, and there was really nothing. There were a lot of stuff on, you know, conceptual books on managing products and so forth, but nothing written by somebody that had gone through all the pains and challenges. And I think if there's one way to summarize what I've written here, the idea is the easy part. And even the engineering is challenging, but that's also the easy part. When you get through designing a product and ready to go sell it, there's so many other elements along the way that can make or break you. It's like a lot of links in a chain, and the design and the engineering is a good portion of it, but it's, I wouldn't even say it's the majority of it. And so this talks about the various other elements that come into play that are important. I write a technology column. I've done that for like 11 years for the San Diego Transcript, which is a small daily business newspaper in San Diego. It has online presence, and so it's accessible online. It's a paid subscription, but there's ways of getting around the door if anybody wants to know. And then I had a company in recent years that has worked with companies and helped entrepreneurs develop products. And typically, the approach I've taken is that any project has certain needs. And I've been resistant to go to these big all-inclusive design companies that offer, one-stop shopping for all. It used to be IDEO, they're out of that business, but these are big organizations that wanted to go study the market and study your customers, and you'd end up spending $1 million before you got through. And what I found made good sense for small projects is to find a team of experts and put them together, develop the project, and you hire the core competencies you need as you build the product. But to get off the ground, it's really good just to have a couple of core people in your company, two or three, and then go find the experts. And so what I've done for companies is do just that. And the most recent product that has a lot of visibility right now is a project that I'm doing for Neil Young. 2 years ago, he came to me. He read the book, and we were introduced by a mutual friend. He came to me and said, "Phil, I have this vision for this product, this music player. I want to bring real music back, and people don't appreciate, they don't hear high-quality sound. They don't feel it." And so my first reaction was, yeah, we can do it. And he had gone to a big company, and they had spent $500,000 in about 3 months, 4 months. And what do they have? I said, show me what you have. And they had all these PowerPoint presentations about here's the market, here's the, you know, this, here's 20 DACs. Which one do you want? His, nothing substantive about creating the product. So I put a small team together, four people. One of them was one of the engineers here at Lime Lab, Simon Gattrell, and two electrical engineers, and myself, an industrial designer. And basically, we worked on the product off and on for 2 years. Off and on because he ran out of money, we had to wait, and lots of stuff. So that's sort of my philosophy. And that's what I do now. Although now most of my time, and pretty much all of it, is focused on this Pono player project. Have you all heard about that?
Yeah.
Okay. So these are sort of some of the products I worked on over the years. I started a company that did this folding keyboard for Palm, and that's where I learned a lot of mistakes. And that's where I learned a lot of stuff to write in the book. You know, if you make a mistake, you can write a book about it. That product down there was an iconic, that was the SX70 camera that came out in late 70s from Polaroid, leather, chrome plated, I mean, ahead of its time. The second generation of the Newton. And then I worked a little bit with one of the companies that PCH has gotten involved with, and that's Lively. So that's the home monitoring health device. And then this is, that's Pono, and that was Neil in September showing it. And of course, that was a dummy unit, but no one else knew it. I met a PCH because I had used, there's a typo there, it's 2006. I had a client, WD-40, that was doing their first hardware product, and I engaged, I've discovered PCH. At the time, they were managing projects. I looked at them as, boy, if they could do what they said they could do, I don't have to travel as much to China. So that was my incentive. And they did a great job of bringing this product into production. I told Liam at the time, you know, this is a great experience. I've been coming over here. I'm dealing with all these little factories, and you should tell somebody about it. And he said, well, why don't you write something about it? And I said, no, I think it's, let me introduce you to a friend of mine, and that was James Fallows, who wrote the first article you probably all read about Mr. China, and that's when the name Mr. China came from in that article. And I've been working with Liam ever since, you know, informal advisor, and just, you know, working with him on various things that have been involved. And as he grew from when I was there, it was a $110 million company. And then when we had to do the Pono player, we had very little money. We needed a partner, and I brought Liam in and to meet with Neil Young, and you know, that's when the relationship first started. So when I started working out in Silicon Valley, I said, you know, how do these little companies survive? You know, big companies have all the resources. I don't think, you all probably know this now, but in the big days, the big companies did the big things. They had the advantage. They had lawyers, they had name recognition, they had distribution, all that stuff. But in a way, it was an encumbrance because it was a lot of bureaucracy. Decisions were made often not on what was best for the product, but was best for the individuals' career position in the company. And now we have so much more resources available. It used to be you couldn't find a good factory over there. You know, Sony had the big factory and you couldn't compete with them. But now, started in the notebook business where companies over there started doing notebooks and for manufacturing, and then they started to build design centers, and they basically said, well, why don't we just do the whole thing? And companies like HP and Compaq and Dell just got out of the design business. They reduced their R&D to very little because these companies in Taiwan had all the relationships, all the knowledge, because they were building the products. And that's spread to all sorts of product categories. The other thing that's been so easy, so helpful these days is hardware has been, you know, the evolution of components. Now you can buy building blocks. The first GPS was all discrete components. Now you can buy a chip and any company can do, you know, a GPS. I remember going over to China for a client that wanted to do a GPS, and there were, you look online, and there's like 100 companies, you know, South China GPS, and say, you know, Shenzhen GPS Corporation. And you go in and you visit them, and they're like building, you know, office room like this with a few engineers putting together stuff. So the building block helps, and obviously the digital tools, being able to communicate across, you know, wide distances just by sending digital files. Incubators such as this, that's the new trend. And then the interest in hardware, there's more, fortunately for all of us, there's more interest in hardware now. You know, when I did the keyboard, there was no one interested in hardware. It was all internet stuff and software. The whole issue of crowdsourcing, which I've become, you know, sort of an instant expert on, trying to set up this campaign and run this campaign. And, you know, the beauty is, you guys, there's no better place to be than Silicon Valley and Shenzhen. You know, these are the two centers of design and of manufacturing. But there's still a lot of challenges in the products you're working on, particularly in this category, because it's become so easy to make products, anybody can do it, and people can knock things off really quickly. So the time to market is really important. You'll find products have very short lifetimes. That means before you get your new product out, you're going to be working on a follow-up. Just the intense competition. The other big issue is retail channels. You know, companies can't get single products into distribution anymore. They're being hurt. They're reducing risk, so they don't want to take on a product that doesn't have a track record. They don't want to work with companies that have only one product. They want to have a streamlined, procurement system. They'd rather take 20 products from one company than one product from 20 companies. It's a lot cheaper. And we all know hardware is much more capital intensive than software. Okay, you got to build inventory, you have a lot of obsolescence, they have long lead times. Right now we're trying to figure, on the Pono Player, we're trying to finish the design of the latest electronics, but some parts have 4-month lead times. So you got to put a lot of money in now. So hardware does have challenges, but you know, for me, it's I love it. I love being able to do a product and I love to touch it. So this is a snapshot a few days ago. I think we're up to like 4.3 million. And this product is sort of setting the record. It hasn't beat, and it probably won't beat Pebble, but in this category, Pebble is in the hardware category, we're in the technology category, and we're the number one in that category. And part of it is from Neil Young, you know, obviously his visibility and his ability to garner a lot of attention. So some of the things I've learned, as I said, it depends much more than, success is much more than just the product idea and even engineering the product. There's a lot of luck. You need to have the right product at the right time and at the right price. And a lot of engineers, and me included, used to think, hey, we build this product, this is great, I know this product, I know it so well, I know it's better than everything out there. But you're done, how do you get the word out? People don't flock to you automatically. And it's very expensive with so many products out there and so many companies. How do you get above all that noise? What you find on the internet particularly is people make ridiculous claims about everything, whether it's true or not. So one of my clients 4 or 5 years back was a headphone company called Edemotic. And they sort of invented the in the ear, and great product. And then you had products a couple of years ago coming out claiming, you know, great frequency response, great accuracy, but they were like 1/10 the price. And if you measured them, they were really bad. But how do you test? There's no independent testing. You know, the magazines that used to do good testing really, you know, pretty much shills for the advertisers right now. They don't, you know, there's no legitimacy anymore. So anybody can say anything, and they generally do. And the person that shouts the loudest, has the most money, gets the attention. What I find a lot of fun is kind of taking an idea and making it into a product. That's really exciting, because it involves a lot of decisions, a lot of thinking, a lot of assumptions. What do you put in the product? What do you leave out? And small companies generally do a much better job than big companies these days, because you have access to resources and you don't have the bureaucracy of these big companies. The other thing that kind of set back and you know, is everything you're going to do, you're going to learn. You're going to learn from mistakes. Nothing you do is a waste of time. When I look back over the companies and projects I work from, I might have made different decisions, but you can learn from every situation you're in, and you build on it and just gather that knowledge. And that's the exciting time that you're in your career. In terms of when you're leveraging to develop products, it used to be that companies wanted to do everything themselves. And that meant longer development cycles, more mistakes. Even when I was back at Polaroid, I was trying to get a couple of products done. And a lot of the technology existed in Japan, you know, optic technology and cameras. I got very frustrated at Polaroid, in that the manufacturing people would take the product, they'd analyze it, they'd send it back to the engineers. Nope, not good enough. And they go through another cycle, and you go back and forth. And it was really, really slow and long and tedious. I just got tired one day and said, I'm going to go to Japan, find a company, manage it, and do it. And that was when Japan was like China is today, where there are a lot of small entrepreneurial companies. So I'm a firm belief, and I've done it for 30 years, do what you do best and let others do what they do best. And, you know, even so many partnerships now, even with potential competitors. NIH is the biggest problem with engineering products. So many people say, I can do it better. You know, I want to be, you know, I'm an engineer, may say, like I would say, hey, I want to be to say I accomplished doing this great design. This is a design challenge. But if it doesn't add anything, and if it's already been done and you can find solutions elsewhere, you're better off doing that. I remember when I did the Newton, mechanical engineer said, you know, we had to put four batteries in, and you know, and battery, you know, the springs and the clips and so forth. And one engineer said, I've got a great idea. I'm going to go off and figure out how to do this. I said, stop. Go out and buy some phones from other products that have already solved this problem. They, you know, products have been out there for years. They've refined it. They know what works. They know what doesn't work. Don't steal it. You know, if it's obviously you don't want to violate any patents. But go look at a few different designs and pick the one that looks the best. And that's what I would call applied research. You know, don't reinvent things that have already been done, because it adds risk and it adds delay. It's really not who gets credit. It's really, you know, getting a great product out there. What I would drive home to engineers is say, a product is only successful if it's successful in the marketplace. You know, you may know, you test it, and you say, this is the greatest spec I've ever developed, but if it doesn't succeed, then it's not successful. The whole process of designing is kind of this little bit of chaos. Some companies have this bureaucratic process. One company that I consulted to, was a company called LifeProof, which made this waterproof case for the iPhone. You could dunk it in water and everything. Very clever design. That company was bought by Otterbox, which turns out Otterbox, the DNA of Otterbox is all the executives came from Celestia, which was a manufacturing company. So everything is processes. So one of the engineers that I worked with at LifeProof, when he started working for Otterbox, the guys at Otterbox would come and say, you're going to do some innovation, we know, but here's the process to follow. We have rules to follow for innovation. So you know, that's scary. You will benefit from some basic processes that help. You know, it's good to define what you're doing in writing. You know, MRD, which I talk about in the book, is a market requirements document. It forces you to figure out what's important, what's not important, lay out what's an A priority, a B priority. When you get further along, you're going to write a product requirements document, communicating to your team what's in, what's not, opening it up for criticism is great. And then set monthly objectives and milestones. Say, okay, this in January, here's what we intend to accomplish in February. So you have some measure of how well you're doing, a feedback method. Figuring out what's in the product and what's not in the product is always a tough thing. Because what you're trying to do is predict what's important 6 or 9 months from today when you're making those decisions, and you don't know what the competition's going to do. So, but it's important not to overly burden a product with so many features that add risk and jeopardize your schedule. The Palm Pilot, which goes back a decade or more, was a good example of where the design was enough good things but not everything. And you know, and how do you figure out that? A lot of it's intuitive. You can do some market research, but I'm not a real believer in focus groups and things like that to design a product. But you just got to find that right balance. It's almost an intuitive feel, or ask others that are knowledgeable. You know, you don't go to a mass group of people and do a focus group. You can go to people that are, you know, maybe knowledgeable in the field. Although when we did the keyboard, we were an engineering company. I went to Logitech. The product cost about $38 to build. I went to Logitech, hoping that, and you know, we wanted to OEM it. And they said, well, I knew the CEO, and we're going to bring in our keyboard expert. And he came in, and he looked at it, and he said, this is a great product. I love it. But it's got to sell for $39. And I said, well, can't do that. I said, it's going to sell for $100. Forget it. It'll be a failure. And that was an expert. So sometimes experts are not expert, really. In a team, one of the important thing, and also is be open and communicative. Search for either opinions. The biggest thing that happens to me is when people come to me or I work with teams, they're afraid to share it. You know, they're afraid to tell anybody. They're afraid to get information that will help them because it means disclosing their product. And it's not that easy for somebody you talk to. I've never seen an instance where somebody I've talked to goes off and copies the product. You know, it just never happens. So there's an over fear of that, that people, you know, don't tell anyone, don't talk to experts or people that may know because they're going to steal my ideas. Feedback is really good to test your assumptions. So, summary, small teams, open communications, leverage the best resources, ask for help, figure out what that good balance of features, and focus on time to market. I asked one of the guys I've worked with in the past, or I know, is Walt Mossberg, who used to write the column for Wall Street Journal. He now has his own site. I asked him, what makes a great product? And this was his response. Open it up to questions and... Hi, Eric, how are you? Yeah, welcome. Eric and I go way back. I'm glad to see he was able to join us.
Buddy.
Yeah.
A few questions I have, but I'll just try to choose one. You said the last thing is great. Like, once somebody knows the product, then it's successful. So we use TiVo as an example, right? Once you get used to stopping live TV, you can't go back. But how do you test that when you have a small number and you're just doing like a quick? Do you actually have to give the product for a few weeks? Like, how can you?
At what stage of the design?
So pretty early stage functional prototypes.
I mean, you know, I think the TiVo is a great product, and I use it. And I have a bunch of them in my house. I think, I don't know the history of the TiVo, but my sense is when the idea came up, it sounded like such an obvious, it was really the next generation of the VCR. It was such an easy, it was such a exciting idea that I don't think they had to really test it to any great degree. They might have had to test the, you know, the functionality of it. But to be able to say, you can watch, you know, it was another DVR. To be able to say, you can record something in advance and watch it had already been out there. What made the TiVo so effective is you didn't have to go find the channel and the time and everything. You would just say, here's the program, go figure it out for me. And, you know, they were the first ones to go to a hard drive. And so I think that was somewhat evolutionary. I think that was just, you know, that was a brilliant idea. And then the second benefit of it was the ability to skip over commercials. So, you know, that was pretty intuitive. And I would sense the people that started the company already were convinced that this was worth pursuing.
About not using focus groups, but you know, more and more popular we hear around here is for this design thinking and kind of building prototype. I think probably similar kind of question, but do you employ that of building simple prototypes and testing with people to see what, how they react, or do you kind of more trust your own gut?
I think when you're in the design process, you make prototypes anyway. So the question is, how can you take full advantage of what you built? And I think it's always good to get feedback. I wouldn't do anything necessarily formal unless you really, I mean, focus groups are good for picking colors, testing user interfaces, do they understand it, is it too complex? But for making design decisions, you know, maybe for which features are important to them, those, that's all good. But for making design decisions, you know, most of the great products are innovations, they're new ideas. They're not necessarily, and sometimes, a lot of people, when you describe a new idea, they can't visualize it very much. So, or they're resistant to something new. So I think you do take advantage of a prototype and get feedback and, you know, looks. And you, obviously you want feedback, you want, you know, do you like the looks of this? Do you like where I put the buttons, you know? But hopefully you'll know to a large degree yourself what you want to do. But it's good to test. You know, don't
maybe even like taste. Like that was kind of insightful to hear. Color, right? You might like the color, but the rest of the world may not.
Yeah,
so that may be something that little level of detail.
And you don't necessarily have to do focus groups. You can you can look at other products. You can see what the hot colors are, what the trends are. You know, there's more experts than you can believe that claim to be color experts, that, you know, like Apple pays millions of dollars to come in and pick the color of a palette or something, you know. Yeah.
So you're talking about time to market and also narrowing down that list of features. And I think, you know, what they were dealing with is, okay, we can get onto the market sooner, but the product isn't as good as we would like. And with hardware, it's not just, you know, it's not just software where you can get an update of, you know. Do we put out a first product that isn't exactly, maybe it's a little bigger or more bigger battery or something, do we put it out sooner to be first on the market? And then kind of that first impression, you only have one time to make a first impression,
yeah.
Right? So there's that, or delay time to market to make something you really, really want to build.
So you're saying, let's say you have a product design and it's bigger than you think you can make it if you had another 3 or 4 months. It's a good question. You got to try to figure out what the competition is. Do you have enough other features to overcome? If size is important, how important is it to what other things you're offering? If you're offering kind of a revolutionary new product, then size is less important. But if you're offering another, you know, Me Too kind of product, and size is important, then you maybe wait. So, you know, I've been working with a company doing a wearable device, and there's got a lot of competition out there, and their claim to fame is, what they want to be their claim to fame is great ID, small, unobtrusive. And so they've had several starts and stops, you know, once they understand the battery consumption, being able to go to a smaller battery. So in that case, they would take the time. So it's there's not a simple answer. It depends on how important size is, but very often you want to, you'll stop and start over again or go back. Because I often hear, well, let's get this product out and right away we'll start a second product. But once you get the first product out, you have an obligation to support it. You know, you don't want to alienate those customers with something 3 months later. It's costly to have two product more, to have an extra product out and maintain it and service it and support it. So just the idea of we'll do a quick product and then we'll do the real product doesn't usually work. Yeah. Yeah.
I have a question. So you mentioned like using focus groups to design. You mentioned using focus groups to design like user interfaces. But like if user interfaces are like supposed to be really intuitive, like how can you expect a focus group to like tell you like what to make that's easier than what they already know?
Well, what makes a good user interface is that it's not unobvious as to how to access the various functions. And when you go into a function, can you get back to where you started easily? And how deep do you have to go in the displays? So there are usability experts that will help design that whole thing. You know, Eric's father's partner specializes in that area. But it's important, you need experts to help you design it, just like graphic, you need graphic experts to figure out what the right look is. And so that's an area where you need expertise, I think. Was that your question?
I guess the analogy that I think of is like, when Henry Ford's like, if I ask what people want, like they'd tell me a faster horse.
Yeah.
And like, it's just like, how do you, like, I feel like a focus group can only get you to like—
No, I wouldn't use a focus group. You know, I would. The focus group in that situation is going to maybe come up with something that you didn't think of, or a function you didn't think of. It's not going to come up with. You're not going to redesign it based on that. Yeah, yeah. One thing I'd like to do is, can we go around the table and can you kind of each tell me what you're doing? Because this is my first. I'm going to be here for another hour after this, but I'd love to. I know a couple people in the class, but I don't know what the products are or what. Maybe just kind of go to.
So I'm Brian Ginn.
Are you from East Coast, by the way?
Boston originally.
Yeah, that's where I'm from as well.
Oh, where?
Quincy and Selma.
Yeah, I'm from Worcester.
Okay. Hard to get rid of that one.
You can't get rid of that one. And I've had more time than you have.
So we're making a smart picture frame. And so if you think of the old digital photo frames that were really kind of clunky.
The cubes, plastic cubes.
Yeah, exactly. So we feel the time's right that we can actually make great user experiences.
Beyond what was popular a few years ago?
Exactly. Real mobile experience, so it sets up the mobile phone, share pictures on the mobile phone, and operate on the mobile phone. Super sleek, thin, minimalist, and less little display technology special sauce.
Cool.
So it kind of doesn't distract at nighttime, it doesn't get washed out in the daytime.
So you know we're doing advanced cooking. Why don't you tell you cook restaurant quality food at home, starting with the grill, does everything your existing grill does, plus makes amazing steak.
Hey, I'm Jesse Vincent. I'm from Somerville, another East Coaster.
Yeah.
From Keyboard.io, we are making new ergonomic design keyboards that are super hackable. So end user firmware reprogrammable, so the open side of things, but also it fits your hands.
I'm Allison Lewis. I'm founder of Switch Embassy. We make washable, fashionable, illuminated garments that you can control with your cell phone, so you can send any image, text, tweet, and have infinite, limited expression through your clothing and accessories.
Wow, I gotta see that.
You can come out.
Sounds,
I'll show
exciting,
you.
Yeah.
It's hard.
I'm John. I'm a blogger, content guy from Highway 1.
Just hanging out.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm Kaya. I'm working with Jesse on the keyboard startup.
Oh,
I'm Sean. Good to see you again, Phil.
Thanks.
I'm working with Eric on the grill product.
Oh, great. Wonderful. That's right. We met on Beats, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Excellent. This is more fun.
Yes.
I'm Amir from Shortcut Labs. We're
creating shortcut buttons for our cell phone.
Shortcut buttons?
Shortcut buttons so that you can control all kinds of functionality.
Oh, cool.
I'm Joe again. I'm with the same team.
Okay.
Shree, founder of ShreeCube. We make a device that lets you stream content from portable devices to your TV.
I'm John. I'm from Photo. We're making a small camera that can stick anywhere.
Hi, I'm Pamela Jennings.
Hi.
Hi. From Construx, I'm developing an electronic construction kit of blocks that look like Tetris pieces, and when you build with them, they draw on a screen the 3D model that you're making. And we're targeting the cognitive rehabilitation and cognitive acuity market for spatial reasoning.
Great.
Hi, I'm Pedro, and with Lumo, we are building an interactive projector for kids.
Projector?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
I'm Megan, founder of Lumo. Okay, you're saying.
Okay, great. Well, look forward to it. I'm going to get out there and walk around in the next hour or so. So that'll be great. Yeah.
I think we could all want to hear a little bit about what you learned about crowdfunding from the point of how you approached it. We just heard earlier, we've been hearing about all the PR expense and ad spend that goes into these days, and I know you had a few.
Yeah, stories. Well, it's funny because Pono, we had a much lower objective than what happened, but I think we decided just a few weeks before we went live to do it, and the ability to do it with a celebrity like Neil Young is obviously a big advantage because there's huge number of followers. But to do it required a lot of work. It's not quite as simple as it appears, and we had a terrific person that managed the whole campaign that has done campaigns before. And so she knew some of the rules and was able to help us quickly move, create the site, which was not, and help us create the offerings and help us create the text, context and the text that goes into the site to talk about the product, what's needed, how much do you tell, how much do you not tell, and then the biggest challenge is now is managing all the comments. You know, like any online community, some of these people, you don't know where they come from, but they come out of the woodwork. And, you know, there's a lot of great comments, a lot of great questions, a lot of great criticism, but then you've got people that know it all and are trying to disprove and debunk, you know, what anyone happens to be doing, or they'll take control of a conversation that goes online, and you know, there's a book to be written about the whole dynamics of this online community. So that just takes a lot of work. We're continuing. I think the general rule about Kickstarter is that you get a big bump in the beginning and then a big bump in the end, and it's pretty quiet in the middle. In our case, we got a big bump in the beginning. It's just not typical, so you don't know what's going to come. And the best thing to do is to offer, put new offerings on, new exciting offerings, to bring in the social community now. So we started, one of the things that's interesting is, and one of my worries is, Kickstarter campaigns are sort of tied in with technology people, you know, and a lot of our audience was well beyond that. But they came, they found us, and I think a vast majority of the people that bought product, not brought, you gotta call it, say a pledge products, first time transaction on Kickstarter. We find problems with Kickstarter, some challenges, like we have these limited editions and people go on, they buy a limited edition, or they pledge for a limited edition, and they're happy and they're excited and they tell their friends and then they go on, oh, I think I'm gonna pledge for a t-shirt. With Kickstarter's rules, even though they kind of tell you, not that well, but your pledge will be the last item you pledge, so you lose the first item. And that creates a major havoc, you know. There's a lot of pressure to tell more about the product. you don't want to tell so much. You got to find that right balance. You can never please anyone. So there's a lot of management of expectations.
Do you engage any outside PR or do any advertising? And then the video is curious too, because you broke a lot of rules. It's like an 11-minute video, and it's just like all these celebrities.
Well, Neil had worked on that for a couple of years, for a year or two. I was with him when he did some of those filmings. They go back to the Grammys in 2012. He just knew he wanted to get people to listen. So two nights before the Grammys, he had his car up on the top of the Staples Center. And all the there was a big event that night for a big an award, and he brought all the people through and he filmed them, and you know, it was pretty mind-boggling. And then he was set. Everyone told him 11 minutes is too long, don't do it. He said we're going to do it, and it's fine. People can watch it or not watch it. But it's like anything else, it's a project, and it needs a project manager, and it needs content. You know, we work with a company called Pentagram in New York that did a lot of the work with us. I had a friend that's a graphic genius, a graphic artist that does everything, jack of all trades. He did all the images, he did charts. There's going to be a big chart going up today that's going to be pretty significant about comparing the different formats. So I had this one guy that I could, he did the signature, you know, we had a signature series, he got the signatures, turns these things around in 15 minutes, 20 minutes. So that, you know, that was a case where you had a really good expert that just was able to really make it come off. It's a team effort. And it's always easy to get people to play on this team when you have famous celebrity. I mean, otherwise you'd be begging, borrowing, and promising money. And money, what, you know, you expect to be paid for this, right? So you should all go on, you should pledge.
It picked up 4.4 during your talk.
Oh, it did?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Good. Thank you. It was slow coming, but I know it was. I remember when Neil gave his speech at South by Southwest. I was sitting down in the front row, and we thought that's when the money would start coming. But when he got on stage before, there were a few hundred thousand, and then I remember partially through, it hit 500,000, and I think that evening it hit 800,000. So, I would say don't count on Kickstarter to save you. Yeah.
I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about industrial design and share your opinion about how, you know, its role, its part in the product development side.
Yeah, that's a great, great question. I wrote a lot about industrial design in the book. I always thought industrial design was really important because it's often just as expensive to make an ugly product as a pretty product, attractive product. I think it's a balance between functionality and art, and I've been on projects where it can tie down the whole project for a long time, and other hand, it can be really the difference between you and all the competition. If you look at products that come in from China, commodity kinds of products, they don't really do much industrial design at all. They are getting better, and a lot of companies are catching on, but I think it's important. And I think you need an industrial designer that is somewhat aware of the engineering needs and does not insist on doing things that are somewhat impossible. So I think it's an important component. And you know, finding an industrial designer and getting the right one is—it's like hiring a lawyer. You know, there's good lawyers and there's bad lawyers or doctors. So that's a challenge. And I like in the case of the Pono, we worked with a guy that is independent, but he was one of the co-founders of IDEO, a guy by the name of Mike Nuttall, who's a brilliant guy and local and easy to work with and understands consumer products. So if any of you guys, you know, need industrial design help, I would recommend him very much. He's a pleasure to work with. Then there are other companies that are finicky and slow and just, they may be good industrial designers, but they're not always very helpful.
Thank you.
Anything else? Well, why don't we go in there? Are you guys all going back to the... All right, and I'll kind of wander around and kind of tell me more what you're doing. Cool. That'd be great. Thanks.